Well, good morning, Catalyst Church. We are blessed that you've chosen to be with us this morning. We're going to worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Please join us. Hallelujah, Lord. Everything for us. Thank you, Tiffany. Thank you, Jesus. Can you feel the Holy Spirit moving this morning? I can feel it. When you move, Darkness runs for cover. And when you move, no one's turned away. 'Cause where you are, fear turns into praises. And where you are, no heart's left unchanged. Justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. When you move, the outcast finds a family. And when you move, the orphan finds a home. Lord, here we are. Oh, teach us to love mercy with humble heart. We bow down at your throne, Jesus. So come. Move. Let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. Oh, come. Oh, so come. Move. Let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. So come, move. Let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. So come, move. Let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for moving in our lives. Thank you for moving in this world, in our community, in our families, in our church. Lord, we owe all we are, all we have to you. And we praise your holy name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, we are holding on to you. We're holding on so tight, Lord. And Lord, I know sometimes it feels like we're grasping at you, like we can't find you, like we don't know where you are. But Lord, we know your presence is here. You are with us always. In fact, your word tells us you will be with us to the end of the age. God, remove the veil from us. Remove whatever it is that's keeping us from you, Lord. Take it away. We want it gone. And we want it replaced with you, everything you have for us, Lord. Everything. And God, I give you praise and honor and thanks because I know that prayer has been answered. It's answered for me. It's answered for you. It's answered for all of us. Thank you, Jesus, and hallelujah, Lord. Welcome and good morning, Catalyst Church. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Good morning, Catalyst Church. So glad you could be with us today. Hallelujah. Hey, before we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, let me just share with you a little behind-the-scenes stuff. What you are watching is pre-recorded. We always record it a little bit ahead of time so that our tech team has a chance, you know, to do the editing and you know, add the different, you know, scripture verses, things like that, yada, 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 all that stuff. So we record it ahead of time. It's not live on a Sunday morning typically. And so here's the thing. Today, this specific one, we purposely have recorded it before the election. So even though you are right now watching this after the election has occurred, we have no idea. And we did that actually on purpose because we want to communicate something very specific about trust. You know, we'll get into that. We're going to start a new series today called Trust. You know, and again, it purposely recorded so that we would have no idea how the election actually transpired. But before we do, let's go to the Lord right now. And again, you know that right now I am leading us in prayer in ignorance about what the election actually transpired, whether or not we even know whether we have a new president or a re-election or whatever, if it's contested. I have no idea. Can I tell you something, though, as we go to the Lord in prayer and hear my heart? It just doesn't matter. God is still God. Jesus is still on the throne. The devil is still a liar. Now, I have an opinion. You know, I certainly have a hope for an outcome. But I can tell you this with sincerity and with authenticity. No matter what the outcome is, it does not affect the fact that Jesus is still on the throne. The devil is still a liar. And that God loves every one of us. Father, right now, we come to you in trust. You hold our lives in your hand. You hold everything in your hand. We trust your sovereign grace, your sovereign mercy. We trust your sovereign love. So be with us in this time and in this season. Lead us according to your design, to your dream. Holy Spirit, speak clearly to our hearts and minds that we would discern your voice and we would know exactly how to move forward in Jesus' name. That's my prayer, Lord. Father, I pray that there are any that are feeling uncertainty, feeling anxiety and fear. I speak against that fear in Jesus' name, and I speak peace and assurance into their hearts. We will have a calm, confident assurance in Christ. That's my declaration, Lord. So, Father, hear us as we pray. As we turn our hearts to you, we attune our ears and our hearts to you. Speak to your people. We are listening. And we will obey. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, amen. Hallelujah, Catalyst Church. Welcome. If you're a guest with us this morning, we'd love to welcome you today. In a moment, you'll see some instructions there on your screen. If you're a guest, we would love to connect with you and just say thank you for joining us and help you become a part of the Catalyst Church family. Take a moment. You'll see there our connections, our text in church. You can text the word Catalyst to 509-385-0811. You can email there. You can click on the little first-time guest button on our online campus. We have several different ways for you to let us know that you were here. You know, I know that right now, if you're watching on our online campus, our online hosts are there and live, ready to pray with you and engage with you. So take a moment, say hello to them, check in with them, and let them know that you're there and participating online as well. Amen. Amen. Hey, let's take a moment and pray over the tithes and offerings if we can. Father, we thank you so much for your continued faithfulness to us. Lord, as we honor you with the tithes, the offerings this morning, I pray that it would be from truly a heart of recognizing gratitude. We recognize all that you have done, and therefore we are grateful. Lord, thank you for it. As we honor you with the tithes and the offerings, Lord, we simply ask that you would be blessed. As you have honored us, we desire to honor you. Would you receive from us today, leverage everything forward into your kingdom? We desire more stories of grace and of mercy and of love, transformation by the power of the gospel. So, Lord, thank you for inviting us to be a part of that. Lord, I pray that your hand of blessing would be upon your faithful. Thank you for their dedication, their sacrifice, and their faithfulness to you. We give today, we receive in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much for your faithfulness in giving to the Lord through the ministries of Catalyst Church. We greatly appreciate all that you do. Amen. Amen. So anyways, this morning we are going to start a brand new series. Before we do, though, I want to share a story about a moment that revealed to me just how dark and depraved the deepest recesses of my heart can be. Now, this is a true story, and unfortunately, it may shock some of you to hear how evil your pastor can be. To be fair, this incident occurred many, many years ago, and I believe the Holy Spirit has changed me in many ways, but I cannot guarantee that the wickedness is all gone. Here's what happened. So before we were married, Bobby and I were out on a date or something, and we went to McDonald's. I know, super fancy date, you know, but we're sitting there eating, and I asked her for a bite of her quarter pounder with cheese. She declined my request, which of course, and gentlemen, you understand this, only made my desire stronger. I begged and I pleaded, I cajoled, and I turned on my vast charms, and I tell you what, vast charms. But eventually she relented, and she handed me her pristine, untouched quarter pounder with cheese, but with a bit of a wary and a watchful eye. And as I took her cheeseburger, I took it in hand, I told myself not to take too big of a bite. After all, I kind of like this chick, and I thought maybe we had a future together. So I told myself to exercise caution and self-control, merely take, you know, the slightest of taste of this delectable treat. I wish I could tell you that I obeyed my inner promptings. I wish I could tell you that my conscience won out the battle. Alas, that is not the case. I shoved 3/4 of that burger into my mouth, my gaping maw bit down, and I handed back to her the remaining little crescent. The look on her face matched the horror of my own awareness of what I had just done. The evil within triumphed that day. And I don't believe that she has ever fully trusted me since. Albeit, it's been 30-ish years, 28 years of marriage, 4 kids, 3 churches, countless dogs and cats later, so I think, you know, we're okay. But still, I catch her every once in a while eyeing me with a hint of distrust. And she will not let me anywhere near her cheeseburgers. So today we're starting a new series. The next 3 weeks, we're going to be examining what it means to trust and how we do it. How we make trusting God the central theme of our lives. Trusting Him, delighting in Him, committing our ways to Him. And we're going to use as our theme verse throughout the series, Psalm chapter 37. Turn with me if you would, Psalm 37. I want to read the first seven verses of Psalm 37. Are you with me? Don't worry about the wicked or envy those who do wrong, for like grass they soon fade away, like spring flowers they soon wither. Trust in the Lord and do good. Then you will live safely in the land and prosper. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you your heart's desires. Commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust Him, and He will help you. He will make your innocence radiate like the dawn, and the justice of your cause will shine like the noonday sun. Be still in the presence of the Lord and wait patiently for Him to act. Don't worry about evil people who prosper or fret about their wicked schemes. I want to open this series with a challenge for us. For the remainder of November, start each day with a slow reading of this passage. Read it several times. Read it in different translations. Read it aloud. Rewrite it in your own hand, in a journal. Be creative, be intentional, be reflective, be purposeful. Sink these verses deep into your heart, deep into your mind, your soul, and your very psyche, and make these verses your own. So as I mentioned earlier, we purposely recorded today's message before we had any clue how the elections would turn out. I wanted to make a strong point about the nature of trust. So let me hit it directly right from the get-go. Trust is utterly unconcerned with circumstances. It makes no difference how a situation or an election turns out. Do I believe this election matters? Absolutely. But whether my candidate wins or whether our country heads in the direction I desire has absolutely zero effect on whether I can trust God and how I go about growing and showing that trust. Do I believe that God cares who wins this election? Absolutely. But whether we as a nation do or do not elect the leader that He desires doesn't affect His love toward us one whit. I mean, if you look to elected leaders, or you look to our country's trajectory, or you look to the health of our economy, or you look to your overall situation as indicators of trust, then you are in for a really bumpy ride and a woefully frustrating life. Trust that depends on circumstances is not the trust that God desires for you and I. Trust that rises and falls with the stock market or the Supreme Court rulings, you know, falls far short of what God dreams for our relationship with Him. So let's take a quick look at trust in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. If you're a note taker, try this. Write this down. Number one, that trust is a pathway. Go back to there in Psalm 37 with me. I want to pick it up. And let's look at these first three verses again. Don't worry about the wicked or envy those who do wrong, for like grass they soon fade away, like spring flowers they soon wither. Trust in the Lord and do good. Then you will live safely in the land and prosper. So now, understandably, David frames the discussion of trust in the context of the seeming prosperity of the wicked. And that's true for you and I. You know, we often see how you know people often seem to get away with wrongdoing, even get rewarded for it. You know, they thumb their noses at righteousness, and it appears they aren't zapped with lightning. You know, we teach our children to always speak the truth, that honesty is the best policy, and yet we secretly harbor resentment against those who lie and cheat and steal, not so much because they do so, but because they do so successfully. Come on, stop looking at your screen so piously. I know you do it. We all do it. We all wonder how the wicked get away with it and whether it might not be so bad after all. But notice something in verse 3. David attaches trust in God with active obedience to righteousness. He says, trust in the Lord and do good. Do good. You know, to understand what David is saying, we also have to understand a fundamental principle of the Old Testament mindset and of Old Testament theology. You know, wherever we read the Old Testament, we need to keep in mind that the authors approached righteousness exclusively as a lifestyle, or better yet, a pathway to walk. Let me use a super simple illustration, if I can. Do you know what makes someone an Olympic figure skater? Yeah, the answer is actually very simple. If they are skating in the Olympics, that's how you know. See, if they're skating in the Olympics, that's what makes them an Olympic figure skater, isn't it? No, I didn't ask, how did they get there? I didn't ask, you know, what it is that makes them, you know, compete at that level of competition, that level of skill. I didn't ask any of that. I just asked, how do we know that they're an Olympic figure skater? You know, because they're skating in the Olympics. Doesn't that sound ridiculous? It kind of does, doesn't it? But that is exactly how the Old Testament prophets, that's how the Old Testament authors approached righteousness. How do you know someone is righteous? Well, they are the ones who do it. From an Old Testament perspective, an Old Testament mindset, how do you know if you're righteous? If you walk on the pathway that God has for you. If you do the things that he's asked, done. It's not complicated, actually. So David can attach trust in righteousness to the active obedience, the pathway, walking it out. Trust is that pathway that you and I walk in our everyday lives. That's why it doesn't matter if it's raining or snowing or sunny or icy or rocky or flat or mountainous or desert or lush or dire or difficult or easy or Republican-controlled or Democrat-controlled, liberal or conservative. It makes absolutely no difference. Now, might some situations seem easier than others to trust God during? Sure. But how does that change the nature of his relationship to us and our relationship to him? If it does, then you've got serious problems. And who controls the Senate or the House ain't one of them. Christ's followers walk a pathway of righteous trust in God, believing that he knows what he's doing and he is capable of holding us in his hand. And we live and we walk the pathway that he lays out for us. He's laid it out in his word for us all, and he leads us individually through the Holy Spirit's leadership in our day-to-day moments. And David ties our righteous trust in God with our righteous trust in the actions he requires of us. And notice the result there in the second part of verse 3, then you will live safely in the land and prosper. Which, let's be honest, isn't that what we're actually all after anyways? Now, you and I don't live in the Old Testament, do we? mean, if we had to draw a line, which honestly we don't, but if we had to, we live in the New Testament. One facet of Jesus' ministry, it is not often talked about or taught about, really, concerns how Jesus served as the pivot point theologically for mankind. Jesus was born into and he lived in it's a thoroughly Hellenized culture. What does that mean? It means that the Palestine that Jesus lived in had more in common with ancient Greece than it did with ancient Israel. The Greek philosophers and the Greek culture, even the Greek language, was the predominant mindset. And that is huge. Jesus is where the Eastern theology of God meets the Western philosophy of civilization. I know, super cool, right? You know, and super pointless when our country is on the brink of turmoil. But here's why this matters, and it's our second point today. If our first point is that trust is a pathway, our second one today is that trust is a condition. Turn with me to the New Testament, Paul's words to the Romans. And in Romans chapter 15, let me pick up at verse 13. Paul writes this, "I pray that God, the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in him. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit." See, where righteous trust in the Old Testament was seen as, you know, as merely a pathway or a lifestyle, in the New Testament, righteous trust is a state or a condition. You and I don't merely operate in trusting ways. We live in a condition of trust. That's the difference. I remember the day that my dad handed me a set of car keys. Not his set of car keys, but my set of car keys. It was still his car, but I no longer had to ask him for his keys. Maybe you had a similar moment. For me, that moment wasn't about convenience. It was about trust. See, it was no longer just me, you know, behaving in trusting ways, driving a trusting pathway. I had proven myself to the point. See, where before I had to ask permission to take his car, he was now telling me I only needed to ask if his car was available. Do you hear the difference? It is a huge difference of trust. The Apostle Paul is praying that we will be filled with the joy and the peace which comes not from circumstance, not from situation, but comes from God himself. And catch this. In Paul's words, it is a result of our trust in God. It is a result of our trust in God. In fact, Paul stops just short of declaring that joy and peace, the condition of our heart and our mind, are a reward for our trust in God. It's one thing to walk in the confidence of our obedience. It's another to be handed the car keys of trust. And don't miss this. It's one thing for God to trust us, or to tell us rather, I trust that you'll do what I ask. It's an entirely different matter for him to simply say, I trust you. That is the relationship that I believe he desires with you and I, more than anything else on this side of eternity. That type of trust relationship. And that is the trust relationship, the relational trust, which Pharisees and religionists cannot accept. They couldn't accept it in Jesus' day, and they cannot accept it still. Anywhere you see religion and rules rearing its ugly head, it is nothing more than a reflection of the insecurities of those who tout them. They fear what lurks deep within their own hearts. They cannot trust themselves, and so they cannot trust others. And here's where it gets really deep and really ugly. Religion is actually only a reflection of their deep mistrust of God. Notice I didn't say faith. And I didn't say spirituality, I said religion. When you and I, when people, when we rely upon the rules of religion, it's about something deeper than merely controlling the behaviors of others. Just because we don't trust them. Religion is our attempt to control God by obeying his rules, obeying them enough that he is then forced to bless us. Did you catch that? And why do people need to trap God in his own system? Because they do not trust him. That's a mind-blown moment, isn't it? So what's the moral of all of this? Let's bring this together, wrap it up a little bit today. The moral is this. Bobby should let me have a taste of her cheeseburgers. She's not displaying her mistrust of me. It's her mistrust of God that keeps me away from her cheeseburger. I'm the victim. That's not actually the moral of today. But do you see how twisted and convoluted we can get in our desire to control? We need to live in trust. Live in a relationship of trust with God. You know, over the course of this past year, we've hit a recurring theme over and over and over again. Faith and works. We saw it in our Keep Calm and Grow Forward series when we were looking at Jeremiah's letter to the exiles in a Babylonian captivity. We saw it in our Denim Clad Disciples series when we walked slowly through the book of James. Trusting God is exactly the same. Albeit, it's a bit in reverse. It's actually works and faith. Remember Old Testament? Trusting righteousness is a pathway. It's a work. It's a thing that we do. We live out in the actions, the choices we make. New Testament, Jesus. Trust is about a faith in the relationship. We walk the pathway of righteousness, of righteous trust, actively obeying his word, and we grow into a state of blessed joy and blessed peace because we live in his trust and he in ours. So whatever the future holds, whatever the outcome of this election actually turns out to be, it makes no difference to what really matters. And what really matters is that our God loves us. No matter any outcome, he loves us. He is committed to you. He is committed to me. No matter the outcome. I love the words of Jesus. I want to close with these this morning. In John chapter 12, verse 44. I love how the New Living Translation says, Jesus shouted to the crowds. He said, if you trust me, you are trusting not only me, but also God who sent me. For when you see me, you are seeing the one who sent me. I have come as a light to shine in this dark world so that all who put their trust in me will no longer remain in the dark. Can I tell you something? I believe that Jesus is shouting those words to the crowd still. He is still shouting to you and I to place our trust in him. That it is the difference between dark and light. Living in the darkness, living in his light. If we trust him. In the remainder of the series, next couple weeks, we're going to be unpacking more about how David outlines for us a life that is marked by trust and grows in trust and shows trust. Because I truly believe we're going to need it. And I'm not trying to be a prophet of doom. Hear me carefully. Hear my heart. But, you know, put my fingers on the pulse, listening to what I feel the Lord telling me and telling so many others, I think we're just going to need to learn to trust in a whole new way, at a whole new level. And for some of you this morning, maybe I could tell you this, that Jesus is shouting to you very individually, very particularly. He's saying he wants you to enter into that relationship of trust with him. He wants you to experience the joy and the peace. And maybe you've not done that before. Maybe you've not asked him, answered his invitation. Can I invite you to do that today? Today, take a moment. Invite Jesus into your heart, into your life, to begin a transformation. It's very simple. Let's just pray together. Use your words, use my words. It doesn't matter. It's not the words, it's the sincerity of the heart. It's the authenticity of it. But let's go to the Lord right now and ask for that relationship of trust to either be truly established for the first time in your life or to be reestablished, to be reconfirmed, whatever the case may be. It's not between you and me, it's between you and him. But let's pray. Father, I thank you so much that you have offered to us, you've offered to me a relationship of trust. And so I invite you, Jesus, to come into my heart, into my life. Show me what it means to walk in a state of trust. What it means to walk a righteous pathway. What it means to have faith. Holy Spirit, I trust that you will guide, you will lead, you will direct. So Jesus, forgive me of my sin, forgive me, wash and cleanse me of unrighteousness, and replace it with your righteousness. I ask it humbly, but in faith, confident. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Scripture tells us, if you pray that prayer, that you are a born-again, saved child of God. Congratulations. And we want to celebrate with you. Take a moment. There'll be some instructions there on your screen of how you can reach out to us. We want to send you a resource to help you in your first steps as a new believer in Christ, a new Christ follower. We want to welcome you to the family. For all of us today, As we embark on a whole new journey of trust, a whole new level of trusting God and of living and walking in that trusting relationship, possibly in the midst of some very tumultuous times, can I leave us with these words, or rather with this blessing? May your days ahead be utterly different than perhaps you have feared they would be. May they be so filled with the joy and the peace. That's why I say utterly different, because I don't know that many of us anticipated the days ahead being utterly filled with joy and with peace. But those are Paul's words. So I want to speak them over us today. May your days ahead be utterly filled with joy and peace because you have the confident hope that results from trusting in God. Father, thank you so much for the blessings of your trust. Help us to walk in it. Help us to live in it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, everyone, for being with us today. Catalyst Church, would you go in grace and mercy and power and confident hope? And we'll see you next time here at Catalyst Church. We love you and God bless you.